Hi, I'm Mary Harrell for Tan Books. If you attend the Latin Mass, maybe you've had friends and family that have asked, why do you like all that Latin? Isn't that hard to sit through? Isn't the new Mass better and just so much more engaging? Well, if you've struggled to come up for answers to questions like these, we have got the book for you. Turned Around, Replying to Common Objections About the Traditional Latin Mass is a practical and clear book that explores the sometimes paradoxical and countercultural elements of the Latin Mass that have been drawing the young and older faithful to the divine for centuries. And its author is here with us today. Dr. Peter Kwasniewski holds degrees from Thomas Aquinas College and the Catholic University of America. He helped found Wyoming Catholic College back in 2006. And now he is a full-time writer, editor, publisher, and speaker whose work is seen all across the internet, but especially at periodicals such as the New Liturgical Movement, 1 Peter 5, Rorate Caeli, and much more. His Substack, Tradition and Sanity, is easily one of the most visited websites in my house. We talk about it over dinner all the time. Peter, thanks for joining us today.
Thank you, Mary. It's a pleasure to be here.
Peter, after all you've already written about the Latin Mass, and there have been so many words you've put down about this. We have the Once and Future Roman Rite published here at TAN. We have Good Music, Sacred Music, and Silence, which is not entirely about the Latin Mass, but certainly includes a good bit about it. Why now this seemingly simpler Q&A book that is really aimed at helping the laity defend, in practical terms, the Latin Mass?
The reason I wrote this book in the format that I chose is that there are a lot of really obvious objections that you can make to this ancient, ancient, very sacred, very solemn, and very foreign mode of worship that the church had for so many centuries. We have to remember that Latin had long ceased to be any kind of common language that people spoke. And yet for centuries, the church kept worshiping in Latin. You know, the Romans stopped wearing garb, that looked like the chasuble, but the priests kept wearing the Roman garb. So what we think of as liturgical vestments is really just ancient Roman clothing, although, you know, it's been developed over the centuries in different ways. The church kept using chant, this ancient form of music that was mostly written in the first millennium, even after music took off and developed all different styles, you know, Baroque and classical and romantic. And so in a lot of ways, the Catholic Church has always, until recently, worshipped in ways that were surprisingly countercultural, contrary to the trends of the rest of society, contrary to the fashions and fads. The church held on very tightly and conservatively to certain traditional ways of doing things. And it's very easy for modern people to look at something like that and say, well, this is just a hidebound institution with a lot of inertia. They don't catch up very quickly. They're really out of date. They really just need to update everything. And that, in fact, was the attitude in the middle of the last century that led to such radical changes to the liturgy, right? That we have to update. And sometimes they also said we have to try to recover the earliest ways of doing things that were lost in the Middle Ages. A lot of that turns out not to be true. It's easy to make these objections. And what I want to do in this book is turn around the objections and say, you know what? It's appropriate that we use an ancient, unchanging, sacred language. It's appropriate that the priest is somewhat distant from the people and doing a lot of things by himself that they're not doing. It's appropriate to have silence and for him to be standing eastwards, not towards the people. All of these things that might just seem like they're ancient, obscure and strange and foreign, they all actually make sense when you drill into the reasons why we do these things. And the church needs them more than ever in the modern world. They're not things that we should get rid of.
Mm. Peter, you have such a wide readership now, maybe as opposed to, 10 years ago, but you have so many people that now turn to you for answers to these questions about the Latin Mass. For the answers you're answering in the book, are these questions that you yourself field or objections that you field still currently from people, or are they ones that your readers send into you saying, how do I answer this to people? You know, I have people accusing me of going off the trad deep end. How do I respond to them now?
Exactly. No, I mean, every one of these objections I've heard many, many times, and I've especially seen them on social media. Social media is a place where everybody feels entitled to an opinion, whether they've done any studying or really deep thinking about it or not. But I appreciate the honesty, you know, that's behind these objections. For example, one of the chapters, I take up the objection, you know, it's all fancy, that is the Latin Mass. It's all fancy like a royal court. It doesn't fit in with a democratic society like ours. You know, why should there be all this pomp and circumstance and ceremony and formality and decorum, you know, and people bowing to each other? I mean, we're not living in the court of Versailles with King Louis XIV. What are we doing this stuff for, you know? And so it's helpful. I think it's helpful when people are honest about what their problems are, you know, and that's why then in that chapter, I go deeply into this question of how scripture, both Old Testament and New Testament, uniformly presents the worship of God as the court of a king in which his courtiers, his servants enter and prostrate themselves. This is one of the most basic images used for not just for worship on earth, but also for heaven itself, what heaven is like. And of course, there are many images used for heaven and for worship, but this is a dominant and central one. And so when we look carefully at what scripture teaches us, we realize, yes, the liturgy needs to have this character. And in earlier societies, it was easier in a way because those societies themselves were royal or monarchical or kingly. And the social and political structure, in a sense, aligned with what scripture presented. So there was a sort of parallel or harmony between, you might say, church and state, to use modern language. But now there isn't that parallel. Our secular society is egalitarian, is democratic, is pluralistic. It has nothing in common with the vision that's presented in scripture. And so we need to hold on even more to that kind of language and behavior so that we remind ourselves, or we are reminded, of what our real relationship is to the Lord. Yes, he calls us his friends, but we're also always his servants. We are his creatures. We totally depend on him and we owe him adoration. So that's maybe an example of a real objection that you can understand where it comes from, and how we need to respond to it thoughtfully.
Mm-hmm. Peter, one of the ones I found myself most identifying with in the book was that why it is better to not understand everything immediately. And in the age of instant gratification, of literally every need, every desire, every question that we can just go to our phone and type it in and get some sort of an answer. We don't have to memorize the answer because, of course, the answer will always be available to us immediately. Again, we don't have to store anything away. I found that one to be very particularly useful, I think, in talking about children, taking children to Mass, so that they come home and say, why did we do that? Or my boys will say, why did the altar servers do that instead of the way it's done somewhere else? So that, a very useful chapter, I think, in answering that particular objection. Is there one that you find to be an objection that maybe is frustrating to answer, or an objection that you find annoyance with in answering again, but you do it anyway because you know these are valuable questions to answer from people?
Yes, I think that the chapter, the objection that comes up very, very often, that I find it surprising how often it comes up, is the objection about the one-year lectionary versus the multi-year lectionary. Yes. So it's maybe not so much an objection as an argument people use against the Latin Mass. They say, well, the new Mass has so much more of Scripture in it. And sometimes ignorantly they say it has the whole Bible. We read the whole Bible, which of course is not true. We read about a quarter of it in the new lectionary, but it's true. There is a lot more scripture in the new lectionary, and that was very deliberately designed after the Second Vatican Council. But what surprises me about that is that no Christians ever thought, well, no Catholics, and no Eastern Christians ever thought of going to Divine Liturgy or to the sacred liturgy as a Bible study, as a place where you were going to get your biblical literacy from. It was simply presupposed that you had some concept of salvation history, that you knew who Christ was, who Moses was, and that you were going to Mass to worship God. And the scripture readings there were not so much to instruct the ignorant, as to remind us of things that we already know from catechism, as we should be well catechized. You can't replace that. But not just to remind us of things we know, but more importantly, to prepare us for Eucharistic communion and for adoring and praising and thanking the Lord. So when you look at the readings in the old lectionary, it's just 1 year, it repeats annually, they're exquisitely chosen, either because they remind us of the moral dispositions we need, the things that we shouldn't be doing and the things we should be doing in order to prepare for communion, or they remind us of the divinity of the Lord and his miracles and his teaching, all of which inflames the heart and prepares us for Eucharistic worship. And so the readings are very targeted in the old rite. They have a very specific liturgical function. And in the new rite, the people who designed the lectionary, they quite literally thought, how can we get through as much scripture as possible? They didn't think about, how is this fitting into the Eucharistic worship? Is this morally or spiritually preparing us for the next part of Mass, which is the culmination of Mass? Mass is not just two chunks next to each other, a liturgy of the word and a liturgy of the Eucharist. It's the Mass of the catechumens, that is those who are being prepared for full communion with the Lord, and then the Mass of the faithful, those who are, at least in theory, able to receive the Lord. So the old division of the Mass really shows how the scripture is ordered to a further purpose outside of itself. And the very repetition of the readings in the one-year cycle means that they can sink in more deeply to us. So every year for the 17th Sunday after Pentecost, we hear the same epistle and gospel. And that, mm-hmm. when you hear something once a year, it actually does stick as time goes on. And you want it to stick because you mentioned, you know, Googling things. If something isn't inside of us, if we haven't either memorized it or at least become familiar with it, it's not actually going to be a principle of our innermost thinking and feeling and willing, right? If it's just out there on a shelf somewhere, or if it's in one ear and out the other, as happens with too much quantity of text, then it really can't have much of an impact on our spiritual life and on our day-to-day life. So this is the paradox, one of many paradoxes. By choosing to do less, the old Mass does more, right? That's the point that I make there.
I feel like I'm sitting through a trad Catholic Answers, like we should be on the radio. This is great. This is great material. Peter, when you're answering objections to the Latin Mass, do you find most often that those objections are coming from Catholics or from the non-Catholics that are curious about the smells and bells and everything, or from those Catholics that are just used to the new Mass and don't get why anyone would want to revert back to mm-hmm. something so ancient and antiquated?
Yes. Well, I think that non-Catholics don't really understand enough about what's going on in Catholic liturgy to really have most of these questions. It would be Catholics who are faithfully attending the Novus Ordo and who are, and I don't use this as a derogatory term, but who are comfortable with it. That is, they know what they're getting. You know, they go there, the priest is speaking to them in their own language. Usually he has a microphone, it's you know, and there are speakers, so it's easy to hear what he's saying. You know, the music is something that maybe they like to sing along with. And so there are a lot of things about it that are very comfortable to them. They're familiar, and familiarity is not a bad thing. But what I hope to move people to do is to try the experiment of going to the old rite and don't think about it too much. Don't try to hush all those inner chattering voices and let it wash over you. Let it speak to you its own language, because liturgy is a language. I said in one of my books, it's a love language, you know, to use that popular expression. So, and there are multiple love languages and liturgy speaks them all. But the old liturgy speaks in a different way than the new liturgy speaks to us. It speaks, I would say, in a more subtle way, in a quieter way, in a more symbolic way, in a way that actually just takes time to absorb. You know, the rituals themselves are so poignant as you watch them, and you can see something like reverence, the spirit of reverence, is really enacted in the traditional liturgy. It's something that's frequently acted out in a way that I think anybody who's just watching will be able to pick up on, right? Without the need for tedious explanations. And it seems like in the New Rite, a big problem is that a lot of things are just talked about. They're not actually exemplified. They're not demonstrated. So we talk about reverence, but we don't really demonstrate it. We don't dramatically act it out. So I think that, again, here's another paradox that I'm going to throw in there, that the old rite is actually more communicative. That's the paradox, is that people would think, well, if there's a lot of silence and if the priest is speaking in Latin and I can't always hear everything he's saying anyway, that it's actually like a brick wall. There's no communication. But I think because of the rich ceremonial and because of the obvious gestures of reverence and because of the symbolism and also just because of the way it quiets you and makes you want to pray, that actually it's much more communicative. It's communicating something that's so awesome that it can't be put into bite-sized vernacular chunks. I mean, you can't do that. So it kind of resists the easy path of easy comprehension. And it takes a somewhat steeper path that is actually going to give you a more beautiful vista when you get to the top of it.
I don't know anyone who puts it better than Dr. Kwasniewski here. Again, the book is Turned Around, Replying to Common Objections About the Traditional Latin Mass. You can find it right here at tanbooks.com or ask about it at your local Catholic bookstore. You can find more of Dr. Kwasniewski's writings at his Substack, which is Tradition and Sanity. The URL is traditionsanity.com. A lot more of his writing there. Peter, congratulations on another terrific publication, and thanks so much for making the time to be with us today.
Thank you, Mary. It's always a delight to work with Tan. Mm-hmm.